Each note legatissimo.
You must get to the point. That's it.
Beethoven remains constantly contemporary. This music really deals with the completeness and the innermost nature of the human condition. It is about the necessity to push yourself to the limit. It does not shy away from the extremes. That out of chaos, out of strife, comes a new order.
Shenyang, China, which is in the northeast region of China, which has 7 million people. It's a very big city. My father, who's playing, who is the leader of the Chinese traditional orchestra in my city, and my mother just loves music. She's not professional. China started as a huge interest for Western culture. I think maybe because American movies are so powerful. I watched a Tom and Jerry cartoon when they played the Liszt Hungarian Rhapsody number 2 together, and I got so excited. And then afterward also I watched Bugs Bunny play the same piece with the ear like this. That was really funny. I started when I was 2 years old because my parents bought a piano. I'm 22. Then I started professionally when I was 3 years old, and then I made my first recital when I was 5. I joined the first time in competition and I won.
Okay, everybody, we're about to start again.
I just love it to perform, and I love the light, and I love the time when I'm on stage. I just totally enjoyed it, and I feel I'm so comfortable, and I feel better than I practice at home. So then I decide, I love piano, I want to be a world-class musician.
Thank you.
It's really wonderful, Lange. No, it's really wonderful. It has so much, color, and it has so much. It has its own grandeur. You know, it's just very difficult to achieve, and you do that really wonderful, and you somehow you manage to get all this, the different sound words to come to the fore. If there is one basic criticism, if you will allow me, is that all this could actually and should be better structured. In the sense that sometimes when you come out of a passage which is very tense and loud, and then you get into the, you know, when you get to play, it's as almost as if you are caught by surprise that this has happened, and I lose the feeling of where you are going. I think the more a piece of music has many different characters and many different colors and attributes, the more it's important to think of it strategically. You don't have to manipulate the music, but you should also not be manipulated by the music. In other words, have always a very clear idea of where you are in the development of the ideas. I noticed that particularly in moments where a new section starts, like... for a moment I thought, where is he going? Where is the music going? You know, I think when you start, when you have a clear new beginning of a sequence, it's like when you write and you finish the paragraph and you start a new paragraph, it has to be very clearly enunciated.
When I was 9 years old, and then I went to Beijing to study Central Conservatory of Music. I mean, certainly the education in China for kids, I don't know whether it's really great, but it's good, you know, because the teachers are very focused into your early on training with your fingers. So when you see the Chinese pianists come in, you know, there's no problem with fingers. But there's something lack. We didn't have a really great education for how to play the style of this piece or how to understand this piece. At school, we don't really focus into how this phrase should be, how, you know, how this style compared to the other composers. I think still this is the distance between the education. So, and obviously that's why I came to America.
I know that it not only it tolerates, but it requires a lot of freedom in the tempo also. This is certainly not a metronomic piece, but sometimes I miss the pulse. If you lengthen the empty bar so much, you soften the impact of the modulation. You can take a little bit of time, but not.
I think that's really.
It is a little. It goes so much that then you go again. Then you have that. There is a basic pulse which you can alter as the music requires. But this, I think, if you find that a little bit in a more strict sense, then all the expressivity will be even stronger. Right? Would you like to start
once
more? Lange, do you think of that all in one, as one instrument, as
maybe when it comes here is something else because the
right. Correct. Yeah. You must play without changing the volume as if it's a new instrument in the orchestra is coming.
Yes, with the harmony. You have no harmony until then the chord will help you. That's right. Don't play the harmony, the left hand too soft. That's it. And also, I think you can make it. You have this for the arpeggio. Then you repeat in a. I think now you have a new texture. It's not this. Must be a little bit. There must be a little bit more contact of this of the finger with the sound. Here you can play like this, but here you need that because it and commentary. It builds up. Unless you play the first group clearly enunciated with the sounds really centered, we will not be able to follow. You must really time it perfectly. Pa-pa-pa-pam. And not too soon. Ya-pa-pam.
Yeah, this is too young.
Ya-pa-pa-pam. Ya-pa-pa-pam. Yeah, this. This. Don't let loose the tension. That's it. When you study, when you practice, when you play the first note, you must hear the last note of the movement. When you start a process of crescendo, diminuendo, accelerando, or ritardando, you must always know what is the end, so that you can then plan the stages of how to get there. Okay? So when you practice something like this, and you want to make sure, you say, where do I want to get? Ya pa pa pa. Now, how do I get there? Pa ta ta ta, pa ta ta ta, ta 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 ta. Ya ta ta ta. Okay?
Yeah.
Once more?
No.
You make the crescendo. You must believe, Lang Lang, you must believe that you can actually make the crescendo on the one note, on the C. That's it. You make your life unnecessarily difficult if you don't play the chord before that really full. This is not full enough.
You mean
here.
The formula,
this is why you play this. You have to. That's it. I think once you hit the fortissimo, you must have a tempo there. But you can play the upbeat if you want a little free. But once you get this is also a rhythmical structure. I don't think you can go a little two, three. Keep the tempo now. Okay? I'm not trying to put you in a straitjacket, but I'm trying to remind you of what the pulse is that you created. If you don't have strictness with syncopations, the syncopations lose their nature. The syncopation is a syncopation in relation to the rhythm. And therefore, if that is free, the syncopation loses its strength.
See.
But this, of course, you can take the time.
Got it. No.
Okay.
Okay. This belongs to a new paragraph.
Yes.
Here.
This is a new paragraph which is going to lead you into this, to the major.
Mm-hmm.
So you need a completely different world from what comes before,
mm-hmm.
and from what comes afterwards. And you know, I think when you play, listen. This is what we need to hear. You know, the resolution of the tension as the principle of legato means two things. One, of course, that there is no hole, that it is bound. As you know, legato means, in Italian, bound. It is bound in the sense that there is no hole, but it is also bound in the connection of the quality of the quantity of sound as well. In other words, when you resolve it, you must resolve it not in accordance with the beginning of the previous note, but in accordance with the end. And if you play, even though it is bound in the sense that there is no hole, because there is no connection in the quantity of the sound, there is a bump.
Mm-hmm.
So I think you must play this a little fuller, the chord, and listen before you play the resolution.
Mm-hmm.
Listen at what point. That's it. Now comes a transformation. Commentary. Again. Commentary. You must always have a complete independence of what is the statement and what is the commentary. It is not. You need really tari, rom, pom, tari, rom. That's it.
Same thing.
No. How? Yeah, you see? Look, this is the extraordinary thing. You are basically here where you were here, except for the diminished note.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
In other words, you could almost be. And make all this section unnecessary. That section is there in order to prepare the change from the minor to the major. This is why this. Not too soft. And little. Start going down.
And then this is kind of a connect.
And you're connecting. And you have made one big transition.
Mm-hmm.
And the importance of the transition is not only that it serves as a link between one section and the other, is that it determines the character of the next section.
The character.
If all this did not exist, if we would rewrite it and simply go. We would have not all this transition that has given us a completely different sound world. Not only in the sense that it is minor, that it is an expressive motive. Him. The character of this, of course, is determined by the fact that it is harmonically very simple,
mm-hmm.
and it is determined by the fact that it is continuous sound. The expression of this is in the interruption. You know, it's like when you're in a situation where you want to say something, and either you don't want to say it straight away, or you don't know quite how you say it, so you say a little bit here, and part here. And then finally you get to the situation where your thoughts are organized, and now you say the whole thing. This is what this is, this kind of a transition. Maybe once more. Yeah. This is too dry. This is. It's too soft. You've got to go. Don't forget, look. Only here there is no tension. Harmonically. This is a search. And now you found it. So don't get too soft too soon. Yes. Yeah. A couple of things I want to tell you. Once you've reached that, when you get there, you must play it as if this music has been there all the time. It doesn't start, but it has been there, and now we notice it. Make sure you don't start. It's already there. And I think for what you want to play the phrase, maybe you start a little bit too loud. Out of this depth of this of the texture also, so low in the piano.
It should be like pianissimo.
Piano. Dolce. Yeah. Dolce. Mm-hmm. And also make sure when you play a figure like this with long notes and short notes, that the short notes are not louder. They tend to be louder, and they sound accented. Keep going. No, open up there. No, subito. No, you cheat, you must play the left hand. That's right, the crescendo in the left hand to the end. That's right. You must always remember, it requires an element of courage to play a crescendo to the end before a subito piano. It takes you the courage to go to the end before you get softer, and not to round it up and get softer at the last moment. Okay, maybe once more, just around there. Maybe if you can play the repeated notes a little drier, then you will get. Open it up. No, this is too fat. Take time if you want, but when you repeat a figure, we're changing the harmony, and you cannot change the tempo, otherwise we don't notice the similarity and we don't notice the repeat. And listen, then you can take time if you want, and then, like, since we are here, when you are here, don't give away. You must think long term. That's what I meant to tell you strategically. Don't give away this pianissimo. You play this pianissimo beautifully, but you mustn't give it away. It's only piano.
That's right.
The pianissimo is only there. So that, that you must miss a breath there because of that. Mm-hmm. It's a sudden change. Mm-hmm. It's not something that has been there earlier.
Expected, yeah.
Very good, wonderful. Wonderful. I think the piano, you must play the chord. I'm not aware that you play the chord really full in the piano. And then you need the sforzando. Now, left hand, full. Piano, but full. That's it.
Oh, damn.
That's
yes,
it.
Yes.
This is the extraordinary thing about music, that you never can see all of it. It's like a mountain that is always one side that remains unseen. And by the time you get to see that side, then you see the other sides in different ways too. And this is a constant process. That's why music is not a profession, it's a way of life. Different from the beginning. It's the beginning of the recapitulation, but it is different from the beginning. Just all you have to do is compare. It must stay there. Also, the first time you really clash. Get to the dominant, yeah. You must really make it more. Maybe just play the rum, yeah. Coming down. But, yeah. Now.
But no tempo change.
Yum, bum, bum. Diminuendo. Only for the change a little longer. Half pedal. Change as often as you can. Two boys. Don't lose the tempo. That's it. I think that's all we have time for today. Do you have any questions or remarks or something? Yes.
My question is to both of you. I'd like to ask what you think are the most important aspects of Beethoven's sonatas in general, as opposed to other sonatas.
This is a very difficult thing.
I don't think you can. Frankly, I don't think you can answer that question. Music is not about pointing out different elements. Music, a work of music, is about integrating all the elements. If you are able to say, this is a very rhythmical thing, this is a very emotional part, this is a very technical part, this is a very atmospheric part, you are not making music. You are only maybe producing some, could be also very interesting and very beautiful sounds. The difference between just sound and music is that when you make music, everything has to be integrated, and that you are not able to detect the different elements. I think that you must always, always think in music. Music is about integration. This is why it is such a sad fact that there is no music education in the schools, because a child that learns from early on to really make music learns about integration, learns about how all the different elements are connected. He learns about the fact that there is no independent element, that tempo is not an independent element, that expression is not an independent element, that everything is constantly and permanently connected. I don't know of a better lesson in life than that.
I have a question for both of you. Do you see images while you play?
Yeah, I do, actually. All kinds of things. Sometimes for Beethoven, I think it's slightly different than Chopin, the image. I feel more, I see more buildings rather than colors. Certainly, of course, you see lots of colors in the music as well. But for those classic pieces, especially sonatas by Beethoven. Yeah. And I think it's more about how to build this building, like what Maestro has just been through, to know the concept of this big construction.
I very seldom have images. I'm more the other way around. I tend to hear music when I see images in life. In other words, I don't think of, oh, in that passage, I see the mountains of Bavaria. It's usually when I see the mountains of Bavaria, I think of the A flat section of this and such and such a piece. But it's true. It's true. Do you have images when you play?
Yeah, that's right.
Well, sometimes when I play, I just think about like an image that, or maybe like a story that just like goes with what I'm playing at that moment and what I'm thinking.
Well, you know, in the end. Music does tell a story. Whether you imagine your own story in words or in sounds, in the end it doesn't matter. What is important is that when you play, you're actually telling a story and the listener gets your story.
I wanted to ask about your comment about the illusion of sound. At one point you said, believe that you can do a crescendo on one note. Now I know physically that's not possible, but it sure sounded like it happened. Can you talk about that aspect of sound, the illusion of sound?
But then it wouldn't be an illusion anymore.
Yeah, that's right.
I play a little bit of piano, and that's
you know,
why I'm asking.
When I was very young, if I can tell you a little personal anecdote. When I was very young, I think I must have been 14 at the time, I was taken to play for none other than Vladimir Horowitz. And I was very unhappy about the fact, because since my childhood, I had been the greatest Rubinstein fan. And Rubinstein knew my parents since the time my mother was pregnant with me. And so since the day I came into this world, this was it for me, you know. And to go and see Horowitz was, you know. So I went already, you know, in a negative frame of mind. And I was 14 and probably very childish, even more so than now. And I played for him. And he said some nice things, and he said some critical things. And at the end of the afternoon, he said something which I have never forgotten. He says, "You know, you must always have will." I thought, what, will job? No, will, of course. Will. In other words, you must want. It's not enough to know there's a crescendo. It's not enough to do the crescendo. You must want. You must have the will to do that. And if you have the will to express things, to bring everything that you know and feel to this expression, and you have knowledge and are conscious of the laws of nature and the laws of the functioning of sound, then you create the illusion. I can explain that this has to be the crescendo, and this has to be because of the harmony and because of the rhythm, for thousands of reasons. I can really explain Russia, but I cannot teach to him the level of intensity of his relationship with the music, how much he will want to. Will he be able to forget at the moment of the crescendo that he had a fight with his girlfriend, or that his mother didn't bring him the groceries, or that? Will he be able to make complete forget all of that and have absolutely burning intensity for the crescendo? This you cannot teach, and this is why you cannot teach what you would call the miracle of the music, because this is beyond the physics. To reduce that to the level of the practical, obviously, if you have a chord on the piano that you want, where you want to create the illusion of the crescendo, you must imagine that the piano is doing the crescendo, and then when you play the next note, that has to be the result of your imaginary crescendo. But if you have a negative way of thinking and say, the piano cannot make a crescendo, you will never express that. But if you play this, and then you play this, and you really imagine this crescendo, then you will play the second chord as if it was the result of the crescendo. I tried my best. It's a very difficult question. Yes.
The late Beethoven sonatas, would you interpret them more or less towards the classical line or towards the romantic line?
I think that the difference between middle and late Beethoven is not a difference between classical and romantic in any way. The difference between middle and late Beethoven, if it can be put in a few sentences, I think has to do with the breaking down of so many elements. You don't have these long phrases. Also, it does away with a conventional idea of what sounds well. If you look carefully, I think you will find that late Beethoven very often ignores the middle register of the piano. It's always like this. You know, the extremes. Late style in Beethoven does away with the theory that one mellows with age. No, this is very important. It's very important. It's as if there is a sort of obstinacy in the sense that it does not require even continuous musical argument. That is enough to start something and then to go somewhere else. It is the abruptness, which is anything but mellow and is anything but romantic. It's as if he doesn't want to allow himself any acceptance of anything with age. And he's obstinate, and he gets on with it. And he breaks everything. Of course, you have moments of great serenity, like in the last movement of Opus 111, or the last movement of Opus 109. For instance, in the arioso of 110, in the last movement, you know, If you look at, if you listen to the music like this, this could be out of middle Beethoven. There's nothing late about it. But because of the content that it comes in, it, I would play that much less fluid. I would, you know, I would play it less clearly. It is more broken, even within the long line. It is more broken in the feeling of it, and you get this very extreme, abrupt changes of dynamics, of register, of mood. In late Beethoven. Sorry, that's the best I can do.
Oh, this, that is great.
Brilliant.
That's brilliant.
Made in.